public hearing? Okay.
Thank you. Hi, thank you all for being here tonight and seeing some friends from last night. We're here, we're going to be having the public hearing for the budget, FY 218, school budget for Conway School. Patty will be giving the details, but I do want to say that last night we had a meeting with the selectmen and the finance committee, and they asked some very, very deep and very thorough questions. We were able to go back today with support from school committee members and Principal Gordon and really go through and look at much more closely at what we were planning on budgeting for. And we were able to move around some things and eliminate a salary, and we're pretty pleased with the result. When we go through it, you'll see that there is a result that is different than last night's. We have worked hard on this thing. So consequently, I'm going to pass it over to Ms. Kavanaugh, our business manager, business services director, and she's going to go through the details. Okay.
I can give it because he's a finance committee member and I need him.
Sure.
And if you could, I'll share over here. Okay, so as Dr. Carey said, last night we met with the town of Conway's select board and their finance committee. And we heard a concern that between our Conway Grammar School budget and our Frontier assessment, the town, we're putting pressure on the town's budget, because if we, there's only a 2.5% levy growth that the town can tax up to. So they expect our budgets to grow no more than 2.5%. The budget we presented for Conway Grammar was up to 5%. And the assessment for Frontier has gone up almost 9%. So that is at 14, and they're expecting 5. So the difference of 8%, they have to go back to the town budget and find 8% to cut. Well, when we carry the majority of their budget, there isn't anything to cut 8% from because their budgets are so small on that side. I don't know how many of you do live in Conway, but you don't have a huge police force, you don't have a huge fire department. So finding 8% on that side is very difficult for them. So we went back today, as Dr. Carey said, with some direction from our school committee and with Principal Gordon, and we have now submitted a budget tonight that goes from an increase of 5% to 2.9%. Now, a couple of things happened last night. Page 1 of 23, this is our student and staff data sheet. This is a new sheet for us. So what happened last night, because we're looking at different numbers today, I was making changes in the budget and forgetting to come here and make the changes to the personnel. So our numbers were off last night. So right now, the biggest change we're going to have is currently we have 15 instructional assistants in the building. Next year we will only have 13. So we are down 2 IAs from our current staff. And let me explain why that is. So if you look at page 2 of 23, we begin this year, our budget was $1,792,630. That's the piece that is given to us by the town. That's our town appropriation. So the salaries for our teachers and IAs that are under our collective bargaining agreements, the 2.5% increase adds $27,456. The steps add $6,848. Adding that new degree column of Master's 45 added $4,592. The lead teacher stipend increased $1,100. And we had new or advancing people on longevity that increased $500. At the end of when we budgeted last year, we had 0.1 day of PT. When we had our roster and our IEP reviews all through the spring, we needed 0.2 PT in this building. So for 1 year only, we financed that 0.1, the additional 0.1, through our SPED revolving. but it needs to come back to our budget this year, so that's adding $6,546. We're adding an allowance for non-union raises of $4,000. The school committee will be presented those in May, and we'll vote on those in June. We had a retirement, and the retirement buyback was $3,226. And then after moving our IAs, when I say reassignment, I'm actually just moving people to the correct bucket, whether they belong on the SPED grant, the WINGS budget, the town appropriation budget, the school choice. So by making some of those changes, we saved $4,223. So other operational increases was on our building and classroom software, $2,971. When our IT director came his first year, he was focused on getting an inventory of our hardware and all of our Wi-Fi, all that. His second year, we focused on who's using what software, where's and where are they. So we came up with a very comprehensive list of all the softwares that we use, either to support our technology or actually instructional software in the classroom. And we then decided how to best allocate them. So with all those changes being made, the cost for Conway went up $2,971. The general instructional supplies, the principal has requested an increase of $1,122. We do belong to the Collaborative for Educational Services, CES. This $965 is our dues. They're not new. We just always paid for them through a grant, and it's not appropriate for us to pay with that grant, so we needed to move those monies over here. We're putting $188 in postage because of the increase, and we increased our professional development stipends $50. We had a decrease in our central office percentage from 10.71 down to 10.14, which decreased overall $3,271, and that brought us to the net change of $52,070. What I do want to make clear to everyone is even though the percentage for central office went down, our actual expenditures for personnel went up because we had two directors that were partially funded by grant, one Title I and the other the kindergarten grant. The kindergarten grant was totally eliminated by Governor Baker, and Title I has been decreasing through a two-stage process. One, nationally, Massachusetts is losing population, so when that money is distributed, Massachusetts is getting less. And then when Massachusetts gets the money, then they distribute it based on their lower enrollment, but also who's got the higher free and reduced, so we sort of take a second cut there. So we want to make sure that we keep our directors in place, so we had to add those salaries. We did have some savings for closing 219 Christian Lane. I'm sure you're all aware that we moved the central office into Frontier Regional Middle and High School, and we did save some money. The estimates right now are conservative because we haven't had a full year of running the building with nobody in it. So there'll probably be more savings next year where that's concerned. So with all that said, our net change is $52,070, or 2.9% increase. The details are on page 3 through page 11, and that's just the town appropriation. Starting on page 12, we look at all our funding. But I want to go to the last page first, which is page 20. So while we're asking the town to appropriate $1,844,700, we'll also be using $143,188 from school choice, $25,000 from our early childhood revolving account, $239,238 from our SPED revolving fund, $10,073 from Title I, and $24,074 from our SPED IDA grant, for a total of $2,286,273 is what we're proposing to spend. On the next page, we're looking at our school choice, and I know it says circuit breaker, but we don't get any circuit breaker funds, so I need to adjust that. So the school committee has always tried to spend our school choice money a year in arrears so that if we had any big changes to school choice, we could anticipate them. But because of the way because our revenue hasn't hit where we thought it would be, we're now spending a year in arrears plus half of our current year revenue. So we were projected this year to end with a negative balance of $68,707. Not that there's negative cash in the account, it's just that we're using $68,000 of next year's income. But when we get our actual numbers in December, it looks like we're only going to be using $60,008. So when we look at 18, we start with that negative of 60, we add our revenue of $171,814. So that would give us available funds of $111,806. And then we are funding, I have the numbers, 6 IAs from School Choice for a total of $143,188. Which means we're spending $31,382 of our next year's revenue. And a question was asked last night from the select board, and I just want to make it clear here so that everyone understands. The town appropriation budget, we have 3 IAs that are funded that way. From our SPED revolving account, another 3, and that is our WINGS program. In school choice, we have 6 IAs, and the SPED IDA grant is 1, funds 1 IA. So that's a total of 13. So it's just so we're clear. So if we look at our WINGS budget, and this was of some concern to us because, as some of you may know, that we have a number of students in 6th grade moving on to 7th. So right now, our revenue for 17 is $295,446 for the children that we bring in from other districts. But next year, it's going to fall to $137,500. I just want to point out to my school committee that our estimate for tuition for this year increased from our last time we saw this. That's why there's a star there, by $7,000, because we have a 45-day placement. So we will end the year with $112,75. Adding the projected tuition of $137,500 would give us $249,575. We fund the director and the teacher, part of a speech, the 3 IAs. We decrease the instructional materials and supplies by $2,000 because we do have a lower enrollment. Field trips $1,500 and extended day services $4,213 for a total of $239,238, which will leave us a projected ending balance of $10,003. 37. And this last page here is just how the percentages roll out based on enrollments. And that's how we cost split. So that is the presentation. If anyone has questions.
I have a question. Just to clarify, you just said on the WINGS budget there was $79,000 for instructional aids.
Mm-hmm.
But you told us that there was just 1 from the SPED revolving.
3. 1 from the SPED IDA grant,
okay.
And 3 from the SPED revolving.
Okay.
SPED revolving equals WINGS. The SPED IDA is a federal entitlement.
Okay. I wrote it backwards. Thank you.
Okay.
Other questions?
I have some questions, but you guys should be asking the questions, not me. But
I want to know what the issue is, why the select board is questioning so much.
Our goal is not to raise taxes in town as any more than we need to. And we requested all the other departments in town to come in level funded. And they worked really hard, and we had tough meetings with them to have them come in level funded. And Frontier is coming in at 9%, and the grammar school is coming in at 5%, which means we will have to make dramatic cuts to the rest of the town or raise the taxes more than we certainly hope to. And we don't have many years until we'll hit 2.5% of our entire value of the town, in which case we will not be able to raise taxes at all. And then we will have to make dramatic cuts in the way we run the town. So we'd rather not get too close to that 2.5%, $25 on a thousand limit. so that we can raise taxes a little bit if we need to. Once we get to $25 on a thousand, we can't raise the taxes at all.
So if this budget would not put you at your cap where you would have to vote an override?
I don't know.
He's saying that that's a future fear.
But, yeah.
It's very close.
Yeah. Once you reach $25 on a thousand, you can't vote an override. I mean, people view as an override like we have this free money, but once you reach $25 on a thousand, you can't vote an override. And then what do we do? I mean, you know, at that point, we will have to make really serious changes to the way we run the town. And anyway.
I can maybe help clarify that. I came out with a budget the end of February, about February 21st. It's on the town website. It is balanced, but there are things that are not in it that I've been advocating for years because we're cutting back. And in fact, my proposal for investing in our own capital stabilization fund is now down from what I'd like to be able to put into our capital stabilization fund. So we are chipping away at things as we go on. But I did present a balanced budget.
Mm-hmm. Trust me, it's not like we enjoy being Simon Legree, and you know, it's not like we don't like the grammar school. My kids went to the grammar school here, and I love the grammar school. The question is this budget a budget the town can afford? And I do have another fear, and many of you remember 15 years ago when the grammar school would come in and present their budget and get the crap beat out of them. And the town, we would have big arguments over why don't we run the school the way Holyoke runs theirs and not fund anything and have a crappy school and who cares?
I mean, go into receivership. That's a great idea.
And those arguments and those arguments always lost.
And they lost, but they were serious arguments, and there were many people in town whose view is, why should we have a good school? What value is it to me to have a good school? And you can say, well, it increases the value of our homes, and I believe that, but if you don't ever plan on selling your house, then the value of your home really doesn't matter that much. What matters is your taxes. And yes, those arguments lost, but people were convinced that we were running an excellent school really thriftily. And by convincing them that the school was being run really on a really tight budget, and yet it was still performing at a high level, people bought into that argument and kind of stopped questioning the school budgets very much. And I think this budget is going to head us right back there again.
All right. I like you. You're a really good guy. But in this instance, your memory is selective. And I would just like to address just a general fallacy. See, this comes up every year. Why don't you run the school more like a business?
I'm not proposing what I just said to you.
But I know. I exaggerate for effect. But the thing about it, see, is that asking a school to do level funding
is impossible.
It's not the cost, the basic costs are the same. We have one class per grade. We are extremely economical already. We have teachers teaching classes of 25, 26 in many schools. That's two separate grades. And by right, it really ought to be. Some of our class sizes, what's the biggest class size right now?
Sixth grade, next year 23.
Okay. And in many schools, in public schools in this state, there's class size limits of 15 that in the more well-to-do part of the state. The whole idea, though, I mean, it's potholes are one thing and kids are another, and the idea that a dollar spent on a kid is a dollar wasted that you can't fix a pothole is is just really kind of tragic. And there's actual data, there's really well-researched data that says that tax dollars spent on education are investments.
In your community.
And that
by
it's,
having an educated population.
There's a great Harvard study that made headlines a couple years ago. It's called "A Dollar Spent on Education is Worth $17 in Local Tax Revenue to Your Town in the Future." And it specifically looked at the tax burden of small towns in Massachusetts. And that's
and I stood up in town meeting when we had these arguments and said exactly what you're saying. I'm not disagreeing with you.
Great.
I'm asking, I'm wondering, I'm looking at this budget. It has nothing to do with last year or next year, but I'm looking at this budget and saying, is this budget, does this budget make sense?
Mr. Armstrong, just for your point of reference, I'm a lifelong resident of Holyoke, still live there, so take it a little easy.
I taught at Holyoke.
And was educated.
I taught math at Holyoke High.
Take it a little easy on the bashing. Totally different populations.
Holyoke is the town that came up in our town meeting many years. I love Holyoke.
Thank you.
I taught Holyoke kids.
What I would request of anybody that says cut your budget is say, be specific and tell us what program you wish to cut and what particular avenue of the future for a child you wish to foreclose. Just be specific and tell us. The idea that you can just cut randomly, achieve this number, and that it doesn't involve actual pain to actual people is just wrong. So if anybody is going to say you need to cut your budget, then have the courage to say, this is what you need to cut. I stand for cutting this. Then we can talk about the merits of what you propose to cut. But the idea that you can just pick a number, that anybody can just pick a number at random and say, achieve this random number to your budget, and that it does not involve just real sacrifice to real people that you like and care about, is wrong.
Especially since increases are dictated by the teacher's contract. So, so that those increases are what they are. It's part of a contract. So then it's left to us to cut everything else, which, so then you have teachers you can afford to have in the classroom, then they don't have the tools that they need to be in the classroom to do the job that you want them to do. So that makes no sense to me at all. So you have a teacher in the classroom, but none of the tools they need, like the infrastructure that's been a part of this, that we've worked diligently to upgrade, financially very aware, piece by piece by piece by piece. We didn't just say all in one year, we're going to upgrade all the internet, or we do it like so carefully and thoughtfully, and how much, what we really need to do now. We're not just like, sure, let's spend the taxpayers' money, I mean, it's unbelievable the discussions we have about, what to do when and how to do it,
I wonder how much we're dealing with an aberration or something more systematic. I want to talk about the WINGS program, and please, people that have been here for a while, edit what I'm saying if I make any mistakes. From my understanding, in the 15 years we've had this program, and it's a very unique program, it's rare when an elementary school has a tuition income program that serves outside students. It's unique. It's been here for a while. There's never been a year that it hasn't received referrals and income. It's run itself. From my understanding, it's run a surplus at times. Mm-hmm. From my understanding, it's run a surplus and has even funded certain things in the building, mm-hmm. like physical structure. Mm-hmm. It's been generous. It's been a provider. This is the first year in 15 years, at this point on March 16th, that we are losing 6 students, which is rare, and we don't know who we're going to receive yet. That's an aberration right now, okay? Questions are, if we get 1 referral, 2 referrals, 3 referrals, how much is this still a conversation, right? It's hard to budget on contingencies, but when you're talking about how the school budget impacts the town, how much of this is an aberration, how much will this program continue to provide, not just for the school, but eases the town budget as well, because it's done that before, right? So
And if we have to send one of those kids out, you're looking at about $100,000. One kid. Three Conway kids are in that program. If we didn't have that program, you're looking at easily $100,000 a kid to send to an out-of-district placement. Depending on the program, depending on transportation, depending on if you can find it, depending on any of those things. So, and we do think we'll get referrals into that program. But we just
are you suggesting that the select board said cut the wings program?
No, not at all.
Okay.
I'm suggesting that it's been a reliable funding source without variation for a long time. And is this an aberration, and should decisions be made about cutting positions that are important parts of the school based on an aberration? We don't even know if it's going to be a problem at this point. Right? So, you know, is it within the acceptable range of, okay, we could handle this. Now, if we didn't get referrals for three years in a row, you're talking something systematic that can't be supported. Fair game, right? But, you know, so that's just a point I wanted to make.
Hello. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Dr. Jennifer Wheeler. I'm a first grade teacher here at Conway Grammar School. I've been here 14 years. I want to thank the school committee. You've always supported our work so admirably. Thank you so much. I want to thank Dr. Carey, Mrs. Gordon, and Ms. Kavanaugh for your work today to bring 5% down to 2.9%. I can imagine the feat that was for you to do today. Thank you so much. I understand there was concern around instructional assistance last night, and I was wondering if you would just humor me and let me tell you a little bit about the instructional assistance in our school. Instructional assistant is a term that's thrown around a lot. It means that that person actually instructs children. They're not teacher's aides. They're not teaching assistants. They instruct children. They're highly qualified themselves. Many of our IAs here have completed teaching programs. They hold degrees. Our IAs are trained by us to implement programs. We informally observe them and give them feedback to make sure that programs and strategies are used with fidelity. They are a vital part of what we do, because unlike 20 and 30 years ago, we have to differentiate what we teach for every child in the class. That is, in my opinion, as a teacher of 17 years, impossible for one person to do well. If we don't want our children to slip through the cracks, we need trained, reliable IAs who can do that. So every child in our class works with someone in reading, writing, math, science, social studies, every single day. So to say that IAs aren't necessary in classrooms that have fewer than 23 students is a fallacy. In a level one school, that's what you do to differentiate. That's how you make education work for every child in front of you. I'm not sure why IAs became a focus last night, but I hope that the school committee and the select board, excuse me, I didn't interrupt either of you. I hope you'll seriously consider that and look more into what the IAs do here and the work they do with our children before any decisions are made to cut IAs. Thank you.
Anyone else?
Yes. So I arrived a few minutes late. So we went from an increase of 1.5 IAs to a decrease of 2.
Correct.
How did that happen?
So what I had said was, that is a new page for us. Dr. Carey brought that budget page. It's a new addition. So I did the page as is from last year and this year just to get a benchmark. But when I was making changes to the budget, I wasn't going back and making the changes on the staffing sheet. So we weren't at 15.5. We were at 13. But because I was trying to keep track of my changes, I did it dollar-wise, but I didn't do it headcount-wise.
So the 3% reduction between what was presented last night and today, Part of it is.
So, and Dr. Wheeler, I agree with everything you say with the IAs. One of our reductions
in IAs is because we do have less children in the wings program. So we do have to right-size that.
Of course.
And as Mr. Band said, if we do get a referral from out of town and they're required for an IA, we'll get them an IA and we'll bill that town for the cost of that IA. So for that part, we're just right-sizing the number of IAs in wings. I mean, that is a responsible cut, one that we need to make. And then the other cut was...
I don't think we can, I'm sorry, I'm not sure we can go into great deal detail about the other cut, other than it was a needs of a check, right?
Right.
Okay. Here, I just want to elaborate on possibly a misunderstanding of, or misperception, I think, of what we ourselves, the Select Board and the Finance Committee, I represent the Finance Committee here, I don't think there's anybody else, this year, I think you're correct in noticing that the eyeballs are scrutinizing the budget probably with greater intensity than any time in the recent past because of the very situation that's been described to you. So some of our frustration is trying to, you folks like to present the budget as this organic whole, where we would benefit if we were able to see the discrete parts of it itemized. For example, first grade. Okay, so here's your population. The first grade, so many from Conway, so many are choiced in. The ones from Conway, here's special needs kid. Of the choiced in, okay, maybe there's none. And then we would like to see, I think, the percent of the IA allocated to each one. And then, because the goal here is not really to challenge your judgments, if I could put it that way, the goal, I think, for us is to look at the different programs and be able to quantify them concretely, not like, okay, we all have this, choice kids, well, they bring money into the school. Well, that's great. On the other hand, it takes four choice kids to make up for one charter kid that leaves. Is that even accurate? Maybe we're operating under the wrong assumption. So I know that, and I don't even think we can even expect that this year because it's a lot of work on the business office end. But I think that, if we could slice and dice this stuff in a more discreet fashion so we could see exactly where the funds are coming from and where they're going. Because I find it extremely hard to see that, the way the budget is presented, and I know others do.
Can I respond to that a little bit? And I'm
sure.
Sorry, I didn't. Roy. So, Roy, because we're dealing with a small school population, any child, regardless if they're a Conway resident or a school choice, have federal privacy rights. And because some of them are on IEPs, there's also HIPAA compliance. So to break it out like you're asking could accidentally identify certain people, and we absolutely cannot do that.
Although on page one, Patty, it says, grade one, 15 students, three special ed, so there are some details
right
there.
But he wants me to say Conway residents, this many IEPs, school choice, this many IEPs. We can't do that. We really couldn't do that because that could accidentally identify.
Well, we aren't asking for specific identification, obviously. And I myself, wouldn't be able to identify because my kids are long grown and I don't have intimate knowledge of the student population. But
I think a lot of the questions that you asked, to my mind, already are answered in the budget as already presented. And I mean, you can figure out what the cost is per grade already by looking at it. You can figure out...
cost per grade, per se. It's trying to evaluate. If we have one... for example, okay, so we have sixth grade, right? All right, we have... in the last I saw...
26 so we have, students.
This year is 26 with seven sped, okay? And... Are there IAs assigned to the sixth grade?
No.
See, we don't really understand that.
I believe they use a lot of the special education teacher in that classroom. Is that not correct?
Well, but see, then you could say, well, there's 0.5 IA in here or 0.6, and there's 0.4 someplace else. So we can,
Perhaps you're thinking more of a budget narrative that would describe.
No, it doesn't even. It can be a grid. I envision it in just a spreadsheet grid that would have this, and then we could sort of go down the columns or rows, and we could summarize and see, at the very bottom of the IA column, we would come up to the total that's here, but we would be able to see where and in which programs the IAs are allocated.
I think that's, I can see that, but also, you're paying a principal and a superintendent and who are up to charge about providing the best situation for the students in the class. So why would they not be using, to the best of their judgment, the right makeup in a class for the students to learn and not, I don't see anybody here just saying, oh, let's throw an extra IA in there just for whatever. I'm not quite sure the point of all that fine detail.
Because we need to understand, perhaps up to now, everybody is very happy to just take numbers as they're presented at the largest, at the topmost level. And what I'm saying to you is the times are demanding that we examine them a little closer than ever before. I don't think that that's an unreasonable
request. I don't either. I've been on the school committee for probably 12 years total, and I don't think anybody takes that. You should see the conversations we have over, like, light bulbs or,
there's an open spot in the school committee. Sign on.
How much paper we buy. I mean, I've never been on the school committee.
Sign on to the open spot in school committee.
One year that it hasn't been unbelievable, the detail. Like, it makes me just crazy sometimes that it's like, have a box of paper. It's really, I've never been on a school committee in my 12 years of being on the school committee where it's just been, oh, let's just pass that budget through and not be very conscious of our taxpayers.
I don't want to monopolize.
Well, I'm just saying, I mean, that's what you charge us with as a school committee, and we're very.
Listen to me, please. Paper clips, boxes of paper, books, software, educational tools, a lot of this stuff is really pales. It's the human element where the costs are. It's the salaries, it's the benefits, it's
totally
the health
agree.
And welfare. You're preaching to the choir over there in that
great.
Regard. And
okay.
That's why we need to examine it as close as we can.
Could I make
that's
a
it.
Point on just on your request there? What you're asking for as well is it's a moving target that we employ a professional to manage that human factor, as you just said, on a day-to-day basis. One day you may have 0.1 FTE here, and next month that may shift a little bit. So she has the flexibility to move her staff around. So to target that cost that you're looking for, I think would be an extremely difficult task.
I mean, I remember one year of school
it's
committee.
It's asking me how many hours I'm a tax collector and how many hours I'm a treasurer.
An accountant can ask that and has a right to ask that, because when they're trying to budget, they need to know, and they need to be as accurate as possible. I'm not trying to come across as the curmudgeon. That's not. I love good schools. Okay, but you must understand. I believe that we need to get out of our normal boxes and normal ways of looking at these things, and it's just the way it is. Well, I didn't create it. I have to respond to it, and that's all I'm doing. And so part of that might be just asking you. And in terms of flexibility, I can address that by you can build flexibility into it. You can say, well, our columns add up to 13.9, but we want to go 14.75 because we want that flexibility. It's because of the flexibility you're talking about. You really are talking about, well, this month we got to go out and hire another IA. You're just talking about reallocating them within kind of like shifting line items in a department budget, if you will.
So we, our account structure is based on what the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education requires, and right now, they do not require us to break it down by grade level, so our accounting structure isn't meant to break it down by grade level. If we were to have to do that, there is only one person that could do that, and that is me. We run lean and mean down at that central office. There's five of us total in the accounting department. And the other four don't do any analysis. They're processing payroll, they're processing accounts payable, and that's their full-time jobs. So to try and take a budget and get it to the level that you're asking for, we would need more people in the central office, and we're absolutely not going to ask anybody for that. And I mean, we'd be happy to go through position by position and talk about, you know, what could go, or I don't see any positions, if that's what we're talking about.
What could go or what not. Maybe it will become apparent that the school is really understaffed, and we need to advocate.
Well, that's been his argument for years.
So I would just like to say that I'm not so sure that I agree with Patty's response to you, that I think if you make any kind of coherent, reasonable request for financial information, that it's our obligation, and certainly my desire, that that will be complied with, that even if it's in an unreasonably lengthy period of time to do so.
It costs money. Are you going to hire someone to do it, Philip?
What's that?
Are you going to hire someone to do it? There will be a
no,
cost
that's why
to
I
it.
Said it might be unreasonably lengthy, but...
You prefaced, and so I don't expect it, that we'd see it this year.
But the one quick thing that you said, because actually, like, when what you're talking about, the IAs, this and that, is nickels and dimes compared to the brief thing that you skipped over, which was the charter school financing issue.
Thank you. And
the fact that our town, like every other town, is just getting killed by charter school financing.
Yeah.
And ask Patty how much we're paying versus for how many kids, and then ask Patty how much we're getting in school choice for how many kids. Mm-hmm. And you can see that the funding formula is so broke, and the trends are so ominous.
We did talk about
and,
that last
and it's
night.
Such it's such against the town meeting prerogative, it's everything about it, that we have no say in how that money gets spent, that they don't get to have to stand up in front of us
You're
and answer it.
To the choir.
Okay. Privatized education.
I wish somebody was on like a governor's council, that they spoke to a governor once a month and could just bring these kind of issues up.
In town meeting, we need to give out a pre-addressed letter or whatever it is that everybody there can send to our representatives talking about the school choice
problem. Well, I will tell you that Trump did present his proposed budget, which is cutting education $9.1 billion, but it's adding 200 and something million to school to charter schools and 100 and something to school choice. It's cutting out PBS and the humanities and the arts and the science.
It'll be privatizing education.
So that's what we're up against.
Just wait till you see next year's.
I do have this. We do this monthly. This is a form that tells us how many resident boys, resident girls by grade, tuition in boys, girls, school choice boys, girls, and total. And we do have this piece here that tells special ed. Now, we can't dig any deeper to tell you, well, it's a tuitioned in special ed person, because that's too identifying. But every single month, our school committee gets a list like this that tells us who's tuitioned in from another district and who's school choiced in, as well as our own residents. So we do have that information.
That's all fine and good, but there's no numbers attached to that.
What?
So
those are numbers.
Their enrollment number, if he wants financial figures.
So, listen, I understand that you're not used to thinking in these terms, and it's unfortunately, a lot of the world has, this is what a lot of the world has come to today.
Well, you have one class for each grade.
Yes, I have. But this is an assumption that you operate under. Has anybody looked at that assumption? Okay. Again, is there a law that says you have to have one class per grade? And look, I don't really don't want this to be a conversation between you.
I'd like to speak to that for a second. Could I? I just addressed that one class, so I assume that means you're thinking of a combined third floor.
No, but that's what you were talking about.
Well. We have what we call, we have the Common Core standards, right? And I'm the third grade teacher.
So I have the Common Core standards that I need to address, and I check them off as I do a review and all that to make sure I've done my job and that the kids are ready for MCAS when that comes up. Okay. If I had a split third and fourth grade classroom, I would have to then cover the Common Core standards for third and fourth grade, and that would not be possible. It's barely possible to get through what I have to get through for a March MCAS. I mean, that's ridiculous in my mind because I teach till June. But I have to make sure I've touched on everything by March, then I go back and teach it even better for the last couple of months. To do that in a combined classroom with Common Core standards would be impossible.
And I think that would have an unintended consequence of more of our residents choosing to choice out because they don't want their children in combined classrooms.
It wouldn't be
and that,
educated correctly.
I totally respect that. And I just, that was just one example of an assumption.
Yeah,
okay?
And I just.
And this is why I said I do not have the fresh thinking to bring to the problems to bear. Mm-hmm. But there might be resources out there. And this, I don't mean to disparage anybody here. That's not my point. My point is, I have looked at our problems, and I've thrown up my hands. I say, I surrender. I don't have the solutions to the problems. And I welcome Finance Committee. You want to come in? Please, come down. Join us, okay? This is, you know, and so that's where I'm coming from.
In 1976, state and federal aid represented 45% of our school budget. This year, it's 20%. That is the alpha and the omega of our story.
Well, so really what that is that we need to educate ourselves and possibly the town that because other taxes have not gone up to increase, to keep that 40%, that this is why the property taxes are going up.
That's exactly
and that's
right.
A perfectly valid argument. I have no.
Well, and to all taxes, it's an inverse relationship. The piece of the government that we pay the most taxes to, we get the least services from. Mm-hmm. And the town where we pay the least amount of taxes, we get the most services from. Mm-hmm. So it's an innately inverse relationship.
Yes. All of this is true. It still doesn't negate a desire to get into it in greater detail, that's all. Not that me personally, I don't want to steal resources that are part of your educational day or anything like that, but I think that you'd have a better time and an easier time selling this thing. Okay.
I see your point, Roy. I mean, how much transparency is necessary so people could make an informed decision and what they're going to support with tighter resources happening every year? I think of the highway department, you know, 2 years ago, and I learned 90% on the town meeting floor. I mean, this is a nice opportunity to ask certain questions and get information so perhaps it doesn't have to go that far.
Is that like learning on the internet?
Yeah, well.
Town meeting floor?
No,
it would be a dangerous place to learn information.
When there's a lot of back and forth with people at the microphone and people are giving different perspectives and the majority of the town is hearing this for the first time and making decisions based on just that information.
Yeah.
I think it's okay to have, you know, you want information to make an informed decision. So conversations like this is important. That's why I wanted to point out the wings phenomenon. You know, this is the first year something like that's happened, and it entails a lot of money. Right?
Well, I also think in 1 year that I was on the school committee, you know, a set of quadruplets moved into town, you know, and three of the four, whatever, had special needs. And the budget responsibility and the way we service those kids and the it was kind of really remarkable, and that's what when you build in a little flexibility. I don't know if any of you were in the school then.
I was a teacher.
Yeah. So, and it was just really kind of remarkable how like that could have been, you know, I don't know how many out of district placements and everything falling apart, and it just.
That was a fine.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
You know, and people don't look at like that kind of flexibility, willingness of teachers to step up, willing of other, you know, educational assistants, what I mean, and that's the kind of school that this is, that You know, nobody's sitting around not doing anything.
Listen, I don't think anybody, speaking of the finance committee, nobody would want to see that change. Believe me, that's not why I'm asking for this kind of change.
I have a question.
Oh,
Meg,
sorry.
Just, I'm curious, well, how many residents now go to charter school at the elementary level? Well, actually, and then at the high school level, if you have it. Yeah.
Much higher at the high school.
So from the town of Conway,
yeah, resident.
We send 2 children at the grammar school level and 11 choice out at the grammar school level. From the 7 through 12.
It was 6 and 10.
6 and 10.
16, yes. 6 choice and 10 charter.
But there's only 2 charter 16. At the elementary level? Is that what you said?
2, yes, 2 charter, and they, one at, where are they?
Chinese.
They're both at the Chinese immersion school.
That's not bad.
And at the 11 that choice out, one goes to Deerfield, one goes to Hatfield, one goes to Leverett, 3 to Mohawk, 2 to Northampton, 2 to Sunderland, and 1 to Whately.
That's the high school, or is that?
That's the grammar school. Yeah. And at the high school, they're going to Hampshire Regional, Hatfield, Mohawk, Northampton, Four Rivers. We have 6 that go to Four Rivers, 1 that goes to the Chinese immersion, and 3 that go to the PVPA, the Pioneer Valley Performing Arts School. So everyone knows what gets me is the Four Rivers, because they're not offering anything different than we do. So what is their charter? I mean, I understand performing arts, I understand Chinese immersion, I don't understand another charter school that's servicing the students the same way we are.
And what does that cost the town?
I gotta do some math.
You said last night, K through 6, $118,000 across is going on.
$18,194 to Four Rivers. Mm-hmm. $21,903 for the Chinese immersion. Per student.
Per student. It's $20,000 per student, $21,000 per student.
How is that okay?
And our cost?
The Pioneer Performing Arts is $18,110.
And what's our cost per pupil?
I have that.
A rough.
$17,600 in total. But then this is a new metric, so they have the in-district and the total. So our in-district is $17,600. Our total is 16.9. So I need to delve further into this to see what the 2 different metrics are that they changed in this report.
And we're still right at state average, like we've always been, or almost right at state average?
The state average is 15,000 for total, and we're at 17.6. So we're over a little bit, and total per pupil is 15.5, and we're at 16.9. So we're over the average
because we're
losses
small enough.
Just got small enough over the past couple of years to.
But if you, Phil, what we were saying last night, if you were to look at the per pupil spending by community and the MCAS scores, they're hand in hand. So the lower communities, their MCAS scores are in the toilet. The ones who spend more, they're your level 1 schools.
Well, we're talking numbers. What's our count for free and reduced lunch?
I don't have that in front of me.
Laura, we did that. It was like 30%.
Mm-hmm. It was higher than usual.
No, 1st through 6th grade was I had to do it for a grant. It was close to 30%, which is actually much higher than it has been in previous years.
Mm-hmm. Was that using the direct certification method that they've just changed to count?
Mm-hmm.
Any other discussion?
So what we talked about last night, I mean, you guys can bash the board if you want, but what we talked about last night was the detail about what these numbers mean so that we might have some attempt at offering, why don't you tell us what to change? And it's impossible for us to propose changes by looking at these numbers. And every time we would look at a number, then there would be a long discussion about whether that person was actually in the wings program or not, and it went on forever. And
with all due respect, Mr. Armstrong, it's not your purview to tell us how to deploy.
Great, but
the school committee. But it's for us to make recommendations to the school committee, and the school committee, that's their one charge, is to do the budget.
But the challenge was, why don't you tell us what to change? I mean, that's what you said. And so if we can have any attempt at thinking maybe changes are possible, we needed more detail than it's possible to get. So we were asking for details or trying to find a way to have these numbers make sense.
Again, I don't think that we asked you what you wanted us to change. I think we were looking for a target percentage that you wanted us to get to.
What we were at five,
and we asked, what would you like to see? What number would you like to see? Not what would you like us to change?
What Phil asked them tonight.
Yeah.
What they would like to change specifically.
And you know what? And there's a part, you know, that to ask that of you is really difficult. I wouldn't want to be you trying to answer that question.
You can be friends outside. It's okay. I love you. Thank you. But I'm trying to read the budget with the eyes of all of the folks that are going to sit in town meeting, and they're going to say no. And maybe not. Listen, I know we all believe
they have never said no. 250 years, Bob. They never said no.
So you can believe that, and you know,
as long as you and your cronies don't say anything.
Oh, I see. Well, I mean, unfortunately,
us and our cronies. What does that mean?
I don't think the job of this group here is to promote the school, you know, to the, you know, unreasonably, right? I mean, you know,
this is about being financially responsible here in town.
Absolutely.
For our residents. That's what this is about.
I'm a resident.
Okay, and so is everybody else in this town. We're not trying to put the school down. We're not trying to question what this committee's doing. We're not trying to question our school officials. What we're trying to do is present a budget to our residents that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we're trying to do.
Thank you. I'm just wondering, gentlemen, and FinCom gentlemen, are you satisfied with the review they've made and they brought it down to 2.9? Does that satisfy your needs, or are you looking for them to take it down, to decrease the budget even more? I'm just curious about what kind of work lies ahead of the administration.
You know, the budgets we got presented last night came out to a total of 6% increase in school budgets, okay? That means that on our side of the budget, the town side, mm-hmm. because you're 55% of the total budget, that means we would have to cut 8% from our side to make it level funded. We can't do that. No way we can do that.
So can you give a number? You want us to cut that 5% completely?
They want it level funded.
You want it level funded.
Can you cut that 5% completely?
No. Not without decimating the school.
As a superintendent, the new superintendent, I know it's easy to say, well, she's new, she doesn't know. But I've been around budgets for over 20 years, and I will tell you, although I was born and bred in Massachusetts and spent most of my life in Massachusetts, I did a lot of work in New Hampshire. They fund education totally differently, and believe me, live free or die. And so these kinds of conversations are very, very common. I do need to tell you, I look at things from a 30,000 foot view. I'm way up here, I'm above everybody else, looking down, I see the town, I understand exactly what you're saying. We had discussion, Mr. Armstrong, we went to lunch one day and had a nice time. I look at the point of view of what's happening at the town side, I look at all those, I listen to what the laws are and what the regulations are from the state and what our needs are. I'm looking down the road at FY19, getting a little nervous, and I'm also looking at the school. I'm looking at the faces of those children. I'm looking at the teachers and the IAs who are working very hard. I'm looking at the principal, I'm calling her, I'm looking, you know, looking through these papers, I look at it all. I'm telling you, at this point, there's no more cutting. Next year is a new year, we're going to start early, very, very early. I really have to tell you, to maintain what we have, we can't, in order to bring in at a level, which was said earlier, because the costs of the CBA for the IAs and the teachers have gone up, because of all those human costs have gone up, we can't level fund anything. Essentially, these costs have gone up 2.5%, we're coming in at 2.9%. We have students with needs that we are meeting here. We're saving lots of money by literally hundreds of thousands by not sending them out. We're doing the best we can. I honestly have to tell you, I do not see any more cuts at this point for this year.
I do also think you run the risk of, if people feel like we're not taking care of student needs in this school, that they will look to more charters, more out-of-district placements, more... You have a very educated and populace here, you know? And they know how to get their kid an IEP, and they know how to get an out-of-district placement if they need it. And then you will blow the school budget out of the water. If this school community starts thinking that kids in this school aren't going to actually get what they need, it could really backfire on us. I don't think it's, we're there at all yet. I mean, I feel like people feel like they get what they need. But, you know, I'm a clinical psychologist. I've run residential treatment centers. I know what they cost. I know what they cost towns. And you have to look at the budget in the context of what people are looking for. And if you start having people go without a district placements for their kids because they don't think their needs are going to get met here, you will really blow the budget out of the water.
All right, the board's responsibility is to all the residents of Conway, yep, and our employees.
Yep.
Okay, we have to provide services to all the residents, you know, police, fire, ambulance, highway. Okay, we have a responsibility to all residents. And quite frankly, we went for level funding in our town side. We can't cut any more on our side either at mm-hmm. this point. So it's going to be a tough town meeting yeah. at this point.
Just a couple of things. First, yes, the cuts will help tremendously. It won't make up for the amount I cut from things that normally I would apply money to, but it goes a long way in that direction. I think what we're doing here, someone mentioned it earlier, and I just want to stress it, that the decrease in state aid over many years is, to my mind, the primary cause of this town gown dispute that's going on now.
Absolutely.
The state auditor made a great report 2 or 3 years ago, which showed declining state aid in general to cities and towns over the last 10 years. That has been made up by town and city budgets. That is what is driving the rise in property rates,
yep,
more than anything else.
Right.
And I would caution us that I would caution against having us think that the primary problem is within the town. Yes, it gets expressed that way because the school is 55-60% of the budget, if you include the technical schools, which we all also have to fund, and you know, out of district technical school costs are a similar financial problem because of lack of aid and the way that the structure is set up.
And those will be good taxpayers
structurally,
someday.
The problem is structural right now. And it's unfortunate that we don't have enough money to fund everything that we need. Mm-hmm. And it's true that we would like to fund things at at least the current level. Without a lot of economic growth, we don't have new growth. It's 2.5% plus new growth. Mm-hmm. There's a little bit that gets tacked on top of the 2.5%, but it's not a lot, especially in Conway. We usually don't have much new growth at all, and we're not going to next year. Mm-hmm. So it's a structural problem.
New growth, you mean people moving into town?
New buildings.
New buildings.
New structures.
It could be utility upgrades. We'll probably get something when Comcast puts in its new wires. Mm-hmm. That'll be a one-time addition. Mm-hmm. If we didn't have any Chapter 70 money, we'd be in a very different conversation right now. And that's really kind of where we're heading with long-term cuts in state aid. So it would be worth focusing on how we can advocate for increased state aid, or at least different state
Absolutely.
Priorities. Everyone does it.
Do.
And if we could turn more of our energy to that, I think we would have a better long-term effect. That said, we're dealing with this year's budget, we're dealing with next year's budget, and we will have this back and forth. But let's not forget that the major driver of this structurally is a long-term decrease in state aid to cities and towns. Governor Baker is trying to hold that steady. Mm-hmm. The MMA keeps advocating, Mass Municipal Association keeps advocating for getting it up to the levels it should be. State aid to highways is a third what it needs to be in order for us to maintain our roads the way they should be maintained. So similarly, and that's another larger town expense. So
I agree. I guess what I'm saying,
talk about a 30,000-foot perspective.
What I'm saying is I think the vision is incorrect, okay? The vision is we have a jewel here we should be marketing, okay? And we're a level one. Could I finish?
Yes.
We have a level one school here that our kids get a great education, okay? Then let's make sure everybody out there knows it. So we do get school choice kids, we do get whatever. And you don't get that by I'm not saying underfunding, I think we could get by on this, but if the word starts getting out that we're like nickel and diming the school or whatever, your very educated populace out here will increase your out-of-district placements, your school choice, your whatever, and you will have a bigger problem. I think you don't go at your budget. You go at marketing. You go at putting what, and not nickel and diming the school. We have a gem here. Principal Gordon says it all the time, and it is true, and I think we all know it. But we don't go at it by, like, just squeaking by. You fund your... Anybody, if you have an asset, you make the most of your asset. This school is one of the strongest assets this town has. Wings is an asset. I know we're going to get referrals to Wings that will bring more money into the budget. But if the word gets out on the street, whether it's true or not true, I think we'll be just fine on this budget. But if it starts to be, oh, that class size, or oh, that instructional assistant, or oh, that, or whatever, you will have people in this town taking their kids out of the school and driving them to wherever they have to go to school, and you'll have a bigger problem than you think you have now, I'm saying.
And what we're saying is, in 10 or 15 years, we're going to be there anyway, mm-hmm. even if we give you now more than we need. So
We're not disagreeing. Okay.
But let's focus on
Tom. Just one more thing that to go on to that I would really like to hear you guys just talk about what value in services you already provide and that the school provides already. That I mean, I have in I don't think that our taxes are by any measure all that are high comparatively to other jurisdictions and to other states.
Look at New Hampshire.
I have a quarter acre lot and a house assessed at $250,000. My property taxes are $3,500 a year. My brother-in-law has a quarter acre lot, $250,000 assessed house in Glassboro, New Jersey. His property taxes are $10,000 a year. And his schools are so much worse. All he gets is twice a week curbside trash pickup. That's the only thing he gets that I don't get.
My family in New Hampshire is $20,000 a year property tax.
May I say something? I agree with everything you said. I want you to use the word marketing. I love that word. We do have a jewel here. It is without a doubt the number one thing, quality of life in Conway, the school is right there, okay? So alongside that, let me ask you this.
Yeah.
Touches on some of what Tom said, looking at the revenue generating side of things, this model, and I'm gonna call this a model, this budget is a model, right? What's the capacity in there for school choice in? Without degradation of the existing program.
That's a process we go through every year. That's not a process we've done yet this year, but we do look at the numbers every year and how much.
Do you have a gut feeling for how many slots would be available?
Principal Gordon?
Mm-hmm. Write essays.
My gut feeling would be. My gut feeling would be. My gut feeling would be 18.
18?
Total.
So that represents $90,000, right? 18 times 5.
That's just a quick.
18 new?
18 in each class?
18 additional students.
It's like slack capacity in a business.
That's exactly right.
So is it part of the,
you have 25 again, this year, Janet.
I've never examined in the detail. Is that part, will that be part of your plan to sort of market those slots once you've got a handle on where those
were? It's been an ongoing conversation on school committee how to address that. Also because, we feel like Frontier is also a very high quality school, and that's where Conway might keep them in elementary and then we lose them at middle school and high school. Because there's so many choices, but
that's a separate problem.
It's similar, though. Mm-hmm. I mean, we still lose if they don't go from here to Frontier and go out. It's
the school choice revenue
issue.
Numbers are alluring, but the flip side of that is that each of those numbers represents a loss to that town and a damage to the town, to the sending town, and it's one of those things where. Especially when you get one town, a Greenfield or whatever, that sends a lot of kids, that is attracted to the quality of the school, and you get, a lot of kids. That is a measurable, harmful impact on that town.
I know, but that
as
should,
a school
that
committee member,
not.
I market on a regular basis. I see it as part of my job.
Okay.
I market the school on a regular basis.
We not
I don't think it's in my job description, but I do it.
Greenfield.
Yeah.
That's not the American.
So the one thing I'd like to say is we're talking about an actual net change of $52,000 over last year. We're all here and we're talking about $52,000. That's the net change from what we were last year to where we are this year. Our salary-related cuts are 2.79. But we have been able to contain things to 2.90, which is only $52,000. So I'm hoping that the voters will agree that this budget is responsible and reasonable, because in this particular day and age, we're asking for $50,000 more than what we used for last year. I'm hoping that that's how they'll look at it.
What I fear in these numbers is that they'll say the number of kids is going down by 9 kids that you have here in this list. And I know that some of the ones in your 132 are school choice kids. It's hard to break that down. But the school numbers are going down and the budget's going up by 3%.
If we can't adequately answer that question and tell that story, then we deserve to lose the budget.
I think Jan needs to do that at that meeting.
Jan did a very nice job last night. This is a quality school. It's a level one school. What we have here is quality, and it's worth preserving.
And you all need to come to town meeting.
All we were trying to ask last night were the things that seemed somewhat obvious, and you can take offense, but, you know, when we have 14 kids in a class, why do we need an aide? You know, and...
I think they answered that for us.
Well, I understand that...
Answered very well. On point.
And all I want to say to the faculty here at Conway is, this isn't the only town we're getting pushback from. All our towns are scrutinizing all our budgets, okay? We have a job to do, they have a job to do. So I'm not offended, Mr. Armstrong.
Not offended either.
You're doing what you were elected to do. We understand that. And we all have to work collaboratively to get the best end result.
And it's really important that they be as transparent, that you all feel that administration is being as transparent and that you're getting questions answered. And
it's gotten so much better than it used to be.
Because if you can't believe what they're telling you, then we all have a problem. And you have to be able to satisfy yourself that what they're telling you is the truth.
Roy, I will tell you this. If you were on the FinCom 5 years ago before I arrived here and you saw what the budget package looked like, you would we give so much more detail now.
Yes.
And every year we add more and more detail so that we can be transparent.
And put things in the right bucket where they belong, where it can be seen what they are versus putting them in, you know, someplace they didn't belong.
One of the things we've taken away from every town, and Dr. Carey and I and the principals have been talking about, the next section to these budgets need to be, what are we doing with your money?
Yeah.
This is, you know, market our school through our budgets. Our
right.
budget should be one of our marketing tools.
I agree.
Show them what we're doing with this money.
Yeah.
What we're doing with the technology. What we're doing with our, and I hate to say MCAS scores, but we're level one based on an MCAS score, and I hate to do that.
Right.
But that's what we are, and we need to tell the people, because we set up our school this way, this is what our kids are achieving. And that's our next goal for next year's budget, is to add those pages in there.
That's great.
I have a question, Patty. So next year we're projecting 20 students in from school choice, and we're taking a total population of 132 students, which is about 20% of our students in Conway Grammar School is school choice. Are there any dictates about the percentage of student population they can school choice into a school?
No.
So we're going to have
once the school committee votes to accept school choice in, It is then up to the school committee to vote the limit that they would like to see in the school. And that's why every year the principal, usually in April, brings forth their recommendations for what they feel we have room for. The school committee usually approves them in May, and then we start either advertising if we don't have the right applications for the right grade levels, or if we've already got the applications, we save our advertising dollars. This year, we feel that we will probably advertise, because not only will we have school choice slots, but we also went from a 4-day preschool to a 5-day, and we want to get that out there too, to let people know we are now servicing your children 5 days. For those families who couldn't send their kids for 4 days and keep them home or have other daycare for that 5th day. So we feel that it is worth spending some advertising money this year to get the word out about our pre-K and our school choice.
Any final thoughts? And we do appreciate the staff and faculty of our grammar school every day.
I have a couple more detailed questions. Should I ask them after the meeting? It would be fine
no,
with me.
No,
we don't need to do them now.
Let them rip.
So when we looked at when you look at these numbers that you handed out, are any of them? Any of the staff, does this include the wing staff as well as the Conway staff, or is this just the Conway staff?
What page are you asking about?
Pardon me?
What page are you asking about?
Page one.
The student and staff data page one, includes all employees funded from all sources.
So can you identify who's in wings? I mean, is it...
You mean the staffing?
You know, I mean, like you have 9 classroom teachers, but there's only 8 grades. So does that mean there's
one classroom teacher
in wings?
One would be considered a classroom teacher because she's the teacher of record.
Yeah, and there's
wings,
so now you have 13 instructional assistants.
There's 3 of them in wings.
And 3 of them are wings plus 10.
And we have.
I mean, there's only and 10 in the grammar school.
Right. And then in the special education teachers, there's 2. One of them is in wings.
Okay.
and then we charge a piece of the speech and language teacher to the WINGS program.
Okay, Mark, yeah. So those are the kind of things we were trying to ask last night, and when I went home and looked over the notes that I took, those are things that I didn't know and I couldn't account for. At the bottom where you talk about teacher credentials, I count 23 teachers. So does that include instructional assistants as well as
classroom teachers? No, just anyone who's in the teacher's contract, which would include our nursing staff.
Okay.
Art, music, PE, even though they're not full-time.
That's what I wanted to know, yeah.
So I count them as a full person having a full bachelor's degree, even though they're only in the building 0.2.
Yeah.
Good question.
That's what we were doing last night,
It's great, and again, it's $52,000 that we're asking for above what was last year.
Now, this adjustment from your discussion last night, you know, and to repeat a question, you know, is it enough? Is it a good faith effort, and does it go enough of a good faith distance? In 24 hours, these people did a lot of hard work, and we're letting go of two full-time equipment.
And we're going to have to see what it does to the rest of the budget.
Yep.
Sure. Yeah.
Well, we heard you last night, and again, we respect you, and we respect everyone on both sides, and we understand we're working collaboratively. We're really on the same team, even though it doesn't sound it. But we did, put the shoulder to the grindstone today and really figured out moving this and this and then taking some, it was a little complex, but we understood what you were saying last night, and we heard it, and we did the best we could, the very, very best we could.
Anything else? We have more meeting to get on to, so. Okay, so that's the end of our public hearing for FY Budget 18.
You can stay, but it's really boring.
Thanks, everybody.
Great.
Thank you so much.
You invite us, we'll go.
Thank you.
Or we'll go with anyone.
See you tomorrow.
I took this page out from you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Take care, Bill.
We heard you, and I get it.
You beat me up. It's okay.
Yes.
I did. I thought it was.
Thank you.
Love small town democracy.
But anytime you want more information, come down. I'll help. I'll dig out as much as I can for you. But that's why I'd like you to be here, because I'd like you to sketch out for exactly what you would like to say. Okay. All right.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks for coming.
Thank you.
Are we ready to move on, Phil?
Oh, yes.
Socializing.
No, I had something that I needed to do.
All righty. Review and approve minutes, January 19th, February 16th. Any comments, adjustments, edits? Can I have a motion?
Okay. Motion to approve.
Second. For January? Is that?
Can we do both at once, or do we have to do
both? Okay, we're doing two?
Yes, because remember you sent us back with an amendment last time.
Okay.
Sorry.
Okay. So
Ira motioned. Okay. Ashley second.
Mm-hmm. For both?
For both.
Is that okay?
Thank you.
We'll just write them 2 times.
Financial statement and warrants.
Okay, so I did send you the financial.
Sorry.
It's hard. We all have to get.
Yeah. I know.
All in favor of approving the minutes of those two meetings.
Aye. The formality.
Unanimous.
Yay.
Sorry. Next. Financial statements.
Okay, so I did send you this morning, and I apologize for the lateness of the report, but I did...
Hi, Betty, you weren't very busy, are you?
Never. I want to bring to your attention a line item that we're going to have an issue with, and I have not been able to quantify it in total yet, but on page 3, our sped transportation, after we did the budget last year, we had students come to us that require special education for pre-K kids. We had no idea they'd be coming in at the age of 2.9, and 3 of them require transportation. So as you can see, we've got $980 left, and we've got February, March, April, May, 5 months of bills left to come. Mm-hmm. So I will try to quantify, I will quantify that for you for our next meeting. And I will, before we meet in April, I will talk with Principal Gordon and find a solution as to how we will fund that shortage. And the other thing I wanted to talk about is our school lunch fund. I have been trying to reconcile with the town, and we are in a deficit. And the difference right now is between our sales and what we're actually collecting. And I know we talked about this a while back, about how far are we going to let families go and owe us. Well, it's so far gone that we're short, and we have to find that money in our budget so we can cut a check to the town to put in the lunch fund so we're not in a negative balance. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So
by how much?
I'm going to go all the way through where we are right now, where Joyce is going to give me, I think she gave me through December. I'd like to have through January so that I know through January what we've got.
We have a student in the 5th grade who hasn't paid for lunch since the day she entered Conway Grammar School.
Well, I think we have to have a conversation. We have to have a conversation about acceptable thresholds.
Right, but we're not going to not feed the kid.
Here, so.
Right.
We send something home that says, like, hey, buy a kid a lunch day or something, and maybe somebody will put in an extra $3.
That's a great idea. Mm-hmm. That's a great idea.
We did well with a stockade at Town Commons for like 100 years. So whatever.
Putting the offender in
whatever,
the stockade?
No, not the child, but whatever happened to the public shaming?
You told me not to do that.
You did.
No, not the child.
You totally said not to do that.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah, that's a terrible idea. You're right.
So, and besides those two things to ponder, we have 6 warrants to sign tonight.
Yeah, you guys didn't sign them all.
In the amount of $39,084.74.
We missed some.
Rely on my folks here.
So are we talking any more about the school lunch thing, or are we going to...
Well, I'll bring it back for either April or May with a definitive amount.
Okay.
What we have to make up.
Small claims court?
That's not...
It costs us more than that,
too. Yeah, no.
I know it.
It costs more to file a small claims suit than it will get the lunch money.
Yeah, no, I think it's $50 to file.
All right.
It's a real delicate issue.
And so they don't qualify for...
We keep sending the papers home, with those high in the hundreds, we send the papers home, and I've talked to Jeannie for people who have done it in the past. She knows the families really well, and she tries really hard. She'll say, well, have them apply this way, have them apply that way, so a lot of the families that are like in the hundreds, they miss it by...
Oh, yeah. I'm familiar.
$200 or something. They really do. It's because they change the formula.
Yep.
All right, we'll tackle that. Anything else?
I like the buy a kid lunch idea.
I love that idea. Mm-hmm. I'm going to do that.
It's better.
I was going to do that for Nature's Classroom. We have a couple kids who can afford it.
Does that work, Patty?
What if we do a fundraiser?
That would be fine.
Bring the lunch to,
That would be fine. If people want to donate, we'll take the donations and we'll deposit them in the school lunch fund to make it be a...
I love it.
I mean, the only dilemma to me is if people can afford it and just ignore it versus...
Yeah. Right, and I think I know...
People that are barely getting by, I'd happy to support those people.
I think most of our overdues are people
barely getting by.
Okay, well then, I'm fine with that.
That's easier to support.
Yeah, sure.
But there's a case-by-case basis to this as well.
So we'll put fill in the stockade and water balloon.
Well, no, I mean...
Here's the thing though, so if you do a buy a kid a lunch program and you get X amount of dollars and it's not the full amount, how do you apply it?
I don't think we're going to do student for student, we're just going to say...
Well, how do you do that?
We're this much in the deficit, we're going to re...
You have to reduce the bill somehow, the overall bill.
Can't we just do it at the end of the year?
Still keep track of who owes what?
So we could, what we could do, what we could do is, we have the list for who owed what at the end of fiscal year 16. So we'll start with that and apply to that first and pull forward.
We can take and divvy it up based on how much title. Because we still have it from last year.
Sure, we can wipe out last year.
Yeah.
Can we apply it to the account without applying to the bills? Not really, because then we're creating a surplus.
Right.
Can we...
Well, that's not a bad thing.
Can we pawn the debt off on the select board and ask them to do something about it?
No, what'll happen, Phil, is they do... Phil, what happens is the amount that we're in deficit...
It's better than TV.
The amount we are in deficit is deducted from their free cash. So...
Well, so they pay for it anyway.
They're but the law says we can't allow that to happen.
All right, we'll behave. Okay, we'll come up with a solution. Public comment, we've had a lot of that. Any more public comment this evening? Okay, unfinished business, we already did the budget. Do we need any more on that?
Well, I think you have a vote, don't you?
This?
Yeah.
I thought it was next. Okay.
Yeah.
Only if you want.
Yeah.
It's got to be done by March.
Have people had enough time to look at the reworked budget from last evening?
Yeah, if that didn't happen, then I'd be wanting to delay the vote, but I have enough information. I mean, I'm comfortable.
Does everybody feel like they have enough information to vote?
I do.
Yes? Yes. Okay.
Forward into the breach.
So we need a motion to approve the FY18 budget at an increase of 2.9%.
Motion.
Do you need the dollar amount? Right? Oh, in the motion.
Right. So the motion would be to approve the Conway Grammar School budget for FY18 at $1,844,700.
Phil still makes a motion.
I made the motion.
Second.
Mm-hmm. Jan seconds.
I made the motion before it was a thing to make the motion.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Thank you for your work on that.
Thank you all.
Yeah.
Appreciate it.
Okay. Now we're on to the June school committee.
So we wanted to have our all school show. We wanted to kick off the 250th celebration, which is the night of the planned June school committee meeting.
Yeah, we can't do it that night.
Right, and so that
that's
night...
That's the grand opening of the Lester Stevens exhibition at the Field Memorial Library.
Okay. So it'd be June 22nd?
Okay,
wouldn't we be the 15th?
Actually,
yeah.
I was asked to convey a request, and that is that would the school committee be... Would the school committee be interested in having the school committee meetings the Saturday of the 250th in the one-room schoolhouse at 9 a.m. and as sort of like a museum display for the paying tourists?
I feel like a museum display.
Yeah.
Can I get an address?
No, we wouldn't have. We wouldn't have to. But the
can I get a horse and carriage drive?
The schoolhouse. The schoolhouse would be whatever. It's right there, and it would be part of.
Pretty cool idea.
So and it would be the first legal meeting in a one-room schoolhouse in like.
Many years.
So we have the ability to make
history.
To make history.
Let's do it, Ashley.
We have to.
So it would be the only way it really fits into like the schedule is Saturday morning because the parade is like late morning, and so we would have to do like a 9 o'clock meeting and be done at like 10 or whatever. So
Saturday the 17th.
Would you
Saturday
be up for?
Saturday the 17th.
I will be in Florida, just so everyone knows.
Yeah?
Sounds dropping like my child off to college.
So June
17th.
In the one-room schoolhouse.
At 9 a.m.?
Where is that, Phil?
It didn't get blown away.
Yeah.
If it wasn't dark, you'd be able to see it.
It wasn't, that's right.
Really good memos about that.
Yeah.
So
So we need a motion?
Phil, you want to make that motion?
Make a motion to reschedule the June meeting to the Saturday morning of the 17th at 9 a.m. in the one-room schoolhouse, the Boyden Schoolhouse.
How do you spell Boyden?
B-O-Y-D-E-N.
Now, what happens at that meeting? We vote on the increases for non-union personnel. Just wondering, it's still an important
thing. Yeah.
June is the last one of the year. Just to be careful that everyone still
if we had
considers
to, we'd
it
have
important.
To do another. We just have to post it and all that. Can we get a horse-drawn carriage ride to the one-room schoolhouse? Come on, you know somebody with one.
You just leave the horse tied up outside.
All right, I'll bring.
What could go wrong?
I'll tie Rosie up outside just for.
and a towel.
Daisy, buttercup.
Will you wear a pinafore? If you give me one, I'll wear one.
All righty.
I'm gonna be sad if I'm watching this tonight. This is going to be a fun one.
I'd like to
send
you
a bonnet. I'll be sending
out an
email.
That's good. We'll let you wear a bonnet.
Okay, so Ira first.
What? I could do it.
Oh,
what's
Phil.
The question?
Phil,
she thought you
were
going
to go.
Phil, I'm sorry.
Oh, did I? Did I second? I second.
Thank
all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Well, you're looking down.
All right. Oh, that's right. Oh, wait a minute. This is
mine.
No.
No.
Have another one.
Okay. New business. Options for making up the tornado day.
All right. So, in the packet that I gave you, there's a letter. This is something to think about for the future, maybe, if the superintendent. There you go, Lynn.
I brought this up 5 years ago, by the way.
You did?
Yes.
If the superintendent and the school committee want to think about this, some schools are doing blizzard bags or options so that you're not running into June 24th, June 27th, last days of school. So what
camp
I want to...
starts.
Yeah. And then your only choice is that or like way at the end of stuff. Yeah. So we'd like to ask the school committee to approve, due to the tornado day, DESE doesn't give out waivers very much anymore. Instead, they let us do different structures. They say it's up to the local school committee to figure out in terms of snow days or tornado days or as to how to make those up. Some of them is the kid, one is that kids come to school and they make up that day. I'm asking.
Why don't we bring him to the schoolhouse when it's on the 17th at 9 o'clock?
Talking to Dr. Carey, did a lot of work on this. Thank you, Dr. Carey. That we give the parents an option of 3 hours of work. The parents sign off on it. And Dr. Carey and I talked about somehow tying it into the 250th celebration. So some examples are listed here for you. And then I've attached a draft letter to the parents where they would sign off and write what they did with their child during that time. I've had quite a few concerns from parents that were going into that following week because camp start.
Now, can we do this for the snow day we just had, too?
I haven't called her. The reason why I contacted DESE about this particular closing was because it wasn't with the rest of the district.
Right.
And it just didn't go well to have this school come when everyone else is done.
Right.
I will need to call again and see if I can't have all 1,600 students have that the day because of the snow.
My home district has adopted the blizzard bags this year, so their day to leave school is like June 9th, and they used it for every snow day that they had, and the teachers took time and put together 5 blizzard bags. Students were sent home with them, and they're labeled blizzard bag 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, no dates, obviously. And then, from what I understand, Dr. Carey, teachers had to be available by phone for a few hours that morning in case parents had questions.
Or internet.
Or internet. Now, that school district chose not to because one of the schools is in a town similar to Conway in that not everybody has high-speed internet. So they had concerns around equity. So teachers were sending home hard copy of things to take care of. And it worked out really, really well for them. Kids were excited about what they were working on. Some teachers used it as just kind of standalone activities. Some teachers used it as like a jumping off for a new unit. as kind of like an exploration discovery activity.
Are you in New Hampshire?
Sounds interesting. No, I'm in Orange.
So okay, because this has been going on in New Hampshire for years. My sister's in Hampstead, and they've been doing it for years, and I brought it to school committee years ago, but DESE had not approved it for Massachusetts yet. But I guess it's starting.
So what happened in Marhar and Orange is that they had special permission to pilot it this year. So I don't have permission to do it for snow days. I could, and so the same person that provides that, Helen Betancourt, gave me permission before the snow day to come to the school committee and ask for an alternative structured learning day, which is what we're doing for the tornado day. I still need to talk to her about the having the extra snow day. I honestly don't know what she'll say. However, I would like to get a committee together to investigate the possibility of doing blizzard bags and getting permission from the state the same way that Terry Thomas did.
That would be great. What happens to the staff?
They're available to be on phone calls.
A work day.
Yeah.
Yes.
So I would just really caution against the embrace of the. First of all, I understand that they're able through data to measure the impact of one loss of school attendance day per year. They can measure that on performance, just missing one day of school per year. And everything I've ever read about all this is that attendance at school, children get more out of it than alternatives. And so when you embrace an alternative for any reason, it's a really slippery slope. If we embrace one bag, let's say a three bag, whatever, how many bags, how many bag day, whatever, then why not, Mr. Finance Committee, why not have a policy of 10 bags? Why 20 bags? Why, we could save so much money with bags, your head would be spinning. And
How old is that data you're talking about?
Well, though? No, I mean, but that's where that heads. And if we, is there a database reason to go to school every day? If there is, then what's the argument to not go to school?
I think the argument is June 24th, 25th, 26th, 27th, because
camp starts.
They're done.
I
think the comparison between them working on February 5th versus June 27th.
So I would actually leave that up to you, but I would just want you to.
No, I think that's fair.
I would really want you to think about where that could go and understand that's an opening.
What do you mean the limit is five?
So you feel like this is a slippery slope?
Yeah.
Okay.
But you can limit being five. Yeah. You still
what do you think? What's five?
What limit is five?
Snow days.
No, we build 5 days in.
No, the blizzard bag days.
Blizzard bag days.
Five. That's it.
I think a blizzard bag day would be way more effective than going to school
on June 25th.
Yeah, my kids are shot.
Yeah,
I would hate to be a teacher like the last day of school because like.
Well, I also think
the bus is like a mosh pit.
Yeah. We're looking at Monday.
You can also think of it as you know, the world is online learning communities.
Absolutely.
Like
it's the time to be outside and go on field trips.
Yes. Educate them about other ways to connect to learning communities if you did it right.
Yeah. Can a parent decide that I'm going to just let my student miss that day? I don't want to do this, so my student has an absence.
On blizzard bag day?
That's, you know, that's,
saying, can they?
That's something that we have to, you know, is there going to be a parent that signs off that says their kid did it and they really didn't?
What I'm thinking, there are parents that, you know, non-compliant that just don't want to deal with it.
And then their child's marked absent for the
day. Is that what happens? Mm-hmm. I'm just wondering what happens.
Mm-hmm.
Did you want to comment?
Dr. Carey, exactly. I was just wondering, did you have a time frame, if this goes through, if the school committee agrees, and it works out, did you have a time frame of when you'd want the blizzard bag completed? Were you thinking April vacation?
By June 17th. The letter, sorry, I didn't give you a copy of the letter.
Okay.
They'd have to be back to us by June 17th.
I see.
We were asking them to take part in some, perhaps a 250th celebration, or to look at Conway history.
Researching facts about Conway and presenting them, one room schoolhouse visit and written experience, prepare a historic family dinner together, Khan Academy, Moby Max, Lexia,
develop your family tree, participate in one of the plays for 250th celebration, you know, that gentleman
great was. Ideas.
Participate in creating a historic float for the 250th celebration, because our list for creating the float is...
Really?
Wouldn't it be great if we could get the kids here on a Saturday?
And do a float.
Do the float?
We're trying to. And that would be our day. That would be our tornado makeup day.
It would.
That sounds like a good bargain.
So...
Otherwise, you're going to school on June.
If any school could do that, to get the kids together, to pull the float on a Saturday, it would be Conway. They would do it.
Absolutely.
So I guess, so we're asking permission to
approve an alternative structured learning day?
For this tornado?
For the tornado day we're talking about.
For the tornado day.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I'm not so sure about that. I'm really not.
So are you nay or are you abstaining?
I'm going to abstain, and I just, if just be careful what you ask for.
Four.
One
abstention. We're on to reports.
Okay. First of all, I did want to, you know, say that Jan really did a great job last night with the...
Sorry, you were the only Lone Ranger.
I was happy to be the only one, I have to say.
It was a difficult meeting, and yeah.
Thanks for that.
We owe you something there.
actually, the first thing on my report...
It was my birthday, I'm sorry.
That's I probably people didn't predict it was going to be, you know...
I think the notice maybe wasn't strong enough. We got a meeting from me. From Donna Hathaway.
Oh, from Donna Hathaway.
There, so there was a meeting notice. Here's the posted meeting notice with agenda, and it maybe could have been overlooked that it was just our meeting notice.
I had the original Monday, and it's my responsibility. I didn't see
so
the
I think nobody really opened it, because there was no language in the email. It was just the attached posting and agenda.
Wow. So that was really heavy lifting that you did. Well done.
For the first meeting.
For the first meeting, I sent a Gmail to everyone.
Yeah, calendar.
I did it. I had all the town administrators in my office, and I sent e-vites for each town.
Proud of you for that.
Yes. I told Tom I invited me.
But then it got canceled, and struck from everyone's mind.
That was the report. I should have seen the updated
And I was going to talk about our math day visitors that Jennifer Wheeler and Maggie West put together, but Jennifer
Paulette
Wheeler
Lechuk.
And Paulette. But would you talk about that briefly?
Sure.
Because that's first on my agenda.
Sure. So we reached out to some community members whose work deals heavily in math each day. So we had Mr. Boyden come over and talk about maple sugaring. And we broke up into groups, so we had the younger kids in one group and the older kids in another group, and they met Mr. Boyden and learned a lot of great things about sugaring here in town and the math that goes into that. He was a really dynamic presenter. They really enjoyed themselves. We also had Dr. DeMeo, who's a Conway resident also and an orthodontist. He came and talked to the children about the importance of math and the work he does. And what was great is they both talked about making mistakes in math and how that's just an opportunity to try again. They were really great presenters. The children were incredibly engaged, and it was a lot of fun. So right now we are working on finding a few more people to come in. We're going to wait until after MCAS season to come in a little after MCAS to present to the kids again, because it was really a huge success. They were wonderful. The kids learned a lot. They were talking about it for a long time afterwards. So we're on the move to maybe do this again, and we were thinking about trying to make it something we do monthly next year. It's a good way to bring community in, but also to have children think about math in a way other than just numbers. That, you know, there's lots of math and exciting things that you do.
I did way more math in my job than I ever thought. Clinical psychologist.
When you stop and think about it.
Well.
Jen, would you talk about, since you're here, the letter we wrote to the first grade parents and about the tree?
Yes. So the children were so sad in first grade that we lost the crabapple tree outside. And one of the kids said, you know, that tree always gave us shade on a sunny day. And another child said, oh, I love that tree. And the next thing you knew, the room was filled with these choruses of how sad it was that we lost the tree, how grateful we were that that's all we lost, because people lost much more than our school did, but that the tree was down. So Kristen and I talked, and then I talked with the class, and we thought it might be great if we could save a part of the crabapple tree. So in the back of first grade, there's an exit door. It's our fire exit. And there's a nice little plot of land there that we often go out to do reading groups. Sometimes we play math games. We write poetry out there in the fall and in the spring. There's really not a place for the kids to sit. So we wrote a letter to the first grade families asking if anyone would help us cut the trunk and move the trunk to use as kind of a makeshift bench for our learning area, our outside learning area there. And not surprising in Conway, within hours, we got emails from, we got an email from a dad who said, I can do the whole thing. And the very next morning, another dad stopped and he offered to help too. So we now have the trunk of our beloved crabapple behind first grade. And one of the things we'll do this summer, we're going to buy some of those big whiskey plant, those wooden planters. I think they're called whiskey barrels. I think. So we're going to buy some of those. We're going to do a little research on native flowering plants and do a little planting out there and just make it a really lovely learning garden for the kids to use. We've spread the word through the school so other classes can absolutely use that area too. But it was a nice way for the kids to kind of hold on to the apple tree and also kind of beautify an outdoor learning space that they've been excited about.
Will the town be able to replace the tree with some insurance proceeds for us?
You're asking the wrong person.
It was a pretty small tree. I bet you the deductible is way more than
as far as the research on the plant, there was somebody that had a grant years back, maybe before you came, that that did a whole landscape.
I had that.
It was
that
a whole
contact.
Landscape thing with a whole series
for
of
nonprofits.
A series of native plantings that they recommended in different really really detailed whatever.
He's
but
he's gonna it, come wonderful. Beautify my clinic in Holyoke and do native great. Planting and fruit.
So that we don't have to reinvent the wheel.
Thank you so much. I appreciate that information.
I'll get to that.
Thank you.
Institutional.
Just want to mention real quickly that unfortunately we don't have a PTO at this time and. The jump rope show, which I haven't seen, I'm so excited for the jump rope show because I've seen the kids practice, but the DeMeo family made a donation for the jump rope shirts for the show because the PTO used to pay for that. So, and then real quickly, we did our Read Across America, Dr. Seuss's birthday, and we had guest readers come in, and it was a great day for the kids. They didn't know what was happening, and we had Superintendent Carey came, and the chiefs came.
I read an X-rated book.
Yeah, we knew Dr. Seuss.
Dr. Seuss, The Cat in the Hat comes back. Look it up sometime.
She was skipping words.
Yeah. Oh dear.
Kill that spot. I'm like, ruin the spot. I've got my piece of wood.
So that was a great day. We had our curl up and read night, which was wonderful. Just to see the kids. They were like laying on dad, and, you know, it was great. We had about 20 families, and of course we want more, but we had a great start to that. We've got professional development I listed here for you. Trail is a mess.
It went right back there, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
So
like went over the salt shed and right down the back there.
Yeah. The kids can't. There's no way they can go on it. We're gonna need chainsaws and everything. So Megan Gump is gonna help me. Come up with a community Saturday that we go out and do that. It's too dangerous for the kids to go out and pick stuff up. It's not as easy as just pick up, so we're going to work on it.
Can I make a suggestion about that? This Sunday, there's a whole townwide thing in the gym, in the school, that it would be a good time to solicit labor or solicit people at that event.
Some landscapers might even just donate.
You'll know about
Megan Gump showed up with, like,
Sunday at 2 o'clock is the 2 to 4.
I know.
The
whole bus of, I got here an hour late and most of it was done. She just came with like these Paul Bunyan guys.
I know.
With like his tools and it was done.
Helped us do the
it was fun.
Well connected people.
Yeah. She's a good connection.
And
she got a hot dog.
The updates you can read, but I did want to tell you something really sweet that happened is, so the second graders from Sunderland Elementary School sent our kids letters. Do you want to speak to that a little bit? Our kids were so thrilled about that.
Right. They were all touched and concerned, right?
Oh. Yes.
And they sent letters over there to try to cheer up the classes.
Our kids were so
thankful. They were very thankful.
My kids said, did you know we got letters? They were really great. Yeah.
That's very sweet.
Yeah, very kind.
So that's my report. And thank you for this approval. And
I'll be working on the snow day. Actually, I
I knew we were going to be at a
You have a budget report, that's what you have.
Yeah. But I did want to talk a little bit, just for a discussion, and it's here, we missed it because it's not, it says discussion items under new business, February, the closing, but then it says discuss school security for week.
Oh, right.
So
sorry about that.
What's happening in the school is, the school is a community resource. Everyone uses it, and they pay for it. We've heard about that tonight. They use it and they pay for it. The problem is that when they're coming into school, there's no one really here in the building to be looking out for the building. And sometimes people tend to go beyond the gym where they're supposed to be.
I correct them all the time.
They go on, they go poking around, not often, but quite some time when the custodian is working, there's rooms that are left unlocked. And we have people going into these rooms, I need to get my son's stuff or my child's things. But they're looking at other students' work, and maybe the teacher has papers, graded papers on the desk and this sort of thing. So then sometimes people are hanging out in the library. So what we realized was that there's master keys to this building, and many, many, many citizens have it, which is okay because it's a community resource. However, those master keys open up all the classrooms as well.
Mine doesn't.
Several do.
Mine only opens the front door.
How do you know?
Because we've tried. Because I tried to get in. I tried to get in the back door.
Yeah.
And I've tried to get in I forget what I tried to get in where else, but
fess up.
Well, it's the front.
I tried to get in the principal's office the one time.
Oh. I think write a message. I could do that because it was last year a year ago or so that we all got a key that would open anything because we only had keys that would open our own doors or the front door. We all had two. That was it. So I couldn't get into Jen's room but I could get into my room.
And then I couldn't get into, right.
So, just recently, 2 years, right, maybe? Maybe? We all got master keys.
When we rekeyed.
I think the other ones that were given out to the community, and I'm not saying some of these weren't given out, but the mass was just to the front door, I believe.
Well, the problem is that our curtain was ripped last week. I'm here often on Sundays and people will come in and I don't know who they are. So I think I would like a system where you have to fill out building use. I don't know who to call about the ripped curtain, for example, because I don't know who was here.
On the stage?
Yeah. Yeah, so just trying to formalize it a little more. So not to say no to people, but just to keep track of who's in the building, when they're in the building, if something should happen.
Basketball.
I was here over vacation, and a woman was sitting out in the hallway on the laptop, and I just went out, and she said, oh, my boys are here playing basketball. My husband's part of the basketball league, and they were Frontier kids. I don't have a problem with, but it's kind of odd to be here alone and all of a sudden you go in the hallway and there's somebody out there and she let herself in and the boys were playing basketball. So it's not about saying no, it's maybe just to formalize it.
I also think the key distribution and collection system, like I still have a key to Frontier. I haven't worked at Frontier and
did you bring that to the next meeting?
Yeah.
I don't even know if it's still there, but it's like things were never
And that's a problem. We're
given out and taken back.
So in my old district, I again was a principal for 7 years. In my old district, the master key to get you in the building, but not the classrooms, was left at the police station.
Mm.
And so I want to go in today, or I need to go in with. I collect the key, I use it, and then I bring it back to the police station, and then I just sign my name. And that's how they kept.
Please don't do that.
It would have to be Baker's store.
Yeah, it would have to be the store.
No, yeah. And that's only up until 7. Basketball starts at 7:30 and goes till 10 o'clock. And before basketball, you're stretching. After basketball, you want a beer. You don't want to go drop off your key at the police station.
So we talked a little bit about maybe getting a fence, but it's not very attractive. A gate that would close off the rest of the building.
Did you see the gate Bruce made? It's really nice. He made a gate it's
cosmetically, it looks really nice.
That's a better idea.
But we come in and the gate's off, because you can lift them, the gate's off and it's on the side, so it's like.
So why are people going down into the nether regions when they only need to be?
I see kids go up there, I tell them all the time, don't go past the sign, they read the sign, parents don't keep track of their kids.
Right.
They're too busy chatting or whatever. Plus, reality is you can go through the back of the stage and access the school.
Yes, uh-huh. So even if you put that gate, yeah.
So you'd have to secure that back door.
And if you have a master key, you could get in the back door, down by the cafeteria, or the
is
out
it
of school
the same
time.
Key to, well, yeah.
A master key will get you in all of them.
I might have. So there's no...
Well, I do think we have to think about this.
Yeah, well, that gate, though, you could put up farther... from the stage. What about right when you come out from the stage?
See, my
that's still before the classroom.
My suggestion would be to just formalize the process more by having people fill out building use forms. And, you know, the head of the basketball, obviously, they should have a key during basketball season.
So the District Act Frontier actually does have a formal use of building policy,
so we know who's here,
which previous attempts to enforce the actual policy in Deerfield Elementary were unpleasant for all concerned. Mm-hmm. I know quite a bit about that. It didn't go well. So, and it's because people have like a whole. The people who you want to get at.
It's a safety issue.
The people who you want to get at and by this thing aren't the people that are damaging this. The people who are going to comply with this all the time are the ones that it's just a hassle to, and the people that are in here randomly and letting their kids run around are the people that aren't going to
I do think
anyway.
It's true. There are so many keys out
so
there in the world,
there.
And I don't think you have any idea. I mean, and we had an issue. We had a, you know, kind of a school committee issue last year, the year before, whenever we had sort of a, let's say, intoxicated person come to the school committee, and then none of us saw him leave. Like, we didn't see him walk out of the building, so we didn't know if he went in somewhere in the building, and in the condition that he was in at the time, we didn't know if there was any, you know, other negativity that was going to continue. We didn't think so, but it just was
I
no
was prepared
way.
To use Patty as a bulletproof shield just in case.
I may be wide, but I can duck.
So can may we put this on the agenda
One of the things that brings up, though, is that, you know, is the building always open if you can get inside?
The classrooms are locked.
Right, I mean, but that's part of it. It's like
cold.
The door's sometimes locked, but if you can get inside, is the building open?
No, classrooms are not locked during the winter months because the hallway is not heated.
We have been doing it this year because of the problems, but then the kids come in and it's really, really cold. Yeah,
there are people that have master keys that will actually get them in classrooms. There are some out there.
Yeah.
Everybody.
If you close the doors to the classrooms, when it's really cold, the pipes will freeze.
That's what happened this year, because I was having them close the doors, and then the pipe...
There's no heat
that's
in
exactly
the hallway.
Right.
Oh, dear.
That's what happened above the wings, because I had them closing the doors.
One of those learning the building, huh?
So, yeah.
Say that again.
I just think about more control, that's all.
Our code, unfortunately.
Just more
control. I think more accountability, sign up, who's here is a good idea. Yeah.
Go ahead.
Unfortunately, our code is also out and about.
Oh.
Our key code is out and about.
That can be easily changed.
Even children, children know that code.
That ought to be changed.
Like that should be changed.
Huh?
Yeah. So, when we added a key code to my doors at the clinic, we changed it monthly.
Yeah. That can be changed.
It's good. It keeps it young and flexible.
Yeah, I know.
It's never been changed.
Okay, so
we will add it to the agenda.
Thank you so much.
Yes.
I appreciate it.
No problem.
Do we need to have anybody else take a look at it to come up with some creative ideas?
Well, we have a quote here for $775 for a gate mechanism that looks like that. Now, I'm not sure if that goes with the Conway theme.
But if they can still get in behind, it doesn't...
Well, what's the point? Yeah.
It's sort of like...
It still would be a deterrent
more than a
to
sign.
Children randomly going
to cross between Southern Border, Ellis Island, and jail.
I know. So then we go back to the keys, and then, of course, we can't lock the doors.
Why do you need to go down the hallway, Phil? Like, they shouldn't be going down the hallway.
Yeah, I know.
What if the kids are playing in the kitchen or something?
I prefer my restrictions of freedom of movement to have aesthetic value.
You can still use the gym. You can still get into the front hallway. You just can't go down the hallway where you don't belong.
I was here during a basketball game where the toilet started to overflow.
Yes.
So it did need to run down to Bruce's area to take care of that.
That was very lucky you were here for that.
Yes, thank you.
It was about to be a disaster. Yes.
Well, I was here for the planting day. It was early in my start here, and I couldn't believe the parents, wonderful parents, who were just
I'm
going to run down to Bruce's office and get a shovel and this and this and this. And I thought, oh my, like, I got a little, like, it was just everyone was all over getting things. And
that is the case. So yes. We need to think about this. Yes. Okay. Ashley, you have anything from Collaborative?
Nope, 29th.
Okay.
Yep.
Can I have a motion?
No, motion to adjourn.
All in favor? Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. 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 Aye.